During the middle of the Gilded Age in the city that never sleeps, where steel meets sky and ambition knows no bounds, two monumental landmarks once soared above the rest, the Astor and Waldorf Hotels. Think of them not merely as hotels, but as palaces of dreams, peak shrines of American extravagance. Erected in 1905, the Astor Hotel was a celestial wonder, an embodiment of Beaux-Arts elegance, crowned by a sky garden that almost touched the heavens. Just a stone's throw away, its sibling rival, the original Waldorf Hotel, had already unfurled its opulence in 1893. A monolith of majestic architecture, this masterpiece was conceived by none other than the iconic Henry Janeway Hardenberg, inspired by the lofty German Renaissance ideals. Yet what fueled such grandiosity? Family, or specifically the Astor family, one of America's most storied old money dynasties. William Waldorf Astor graced Fifth Avenue with the Waldorf first, laying down the gauntlet. Not to be outdone, his cousin John Jacob Astor IV took the challenge head-on, responding with the Astoria Hotel, each structure a flamboyant rebuttal to the other. And yet, despite standing as monoliths of splendor, these icons of opulence faced an unforeseeable destiny. They eroded, crumbled, and ultimately were razed to the ground. In this thrilling installment of Old Money Mansions, join us as we retell a saga that consistently echoes through the corridors of architectural history. Why were New York's most opulent hotels demolished? In the bustling urban landscape of Gilded Age New York City, amidst Fifth Avenue's burgeoning architectural splendor, emerged the unparalleled duo of the Astor and Waldorf Hotels. Stemming from a family rivalry between the affluent cousins, William Waldorf Astor and John Jacob Astor IV, these luxurious havens were erected as monuments to both grandeur and one-upmanship. It all begins in 1893 when William Waldorf Astor inaugurated the Waldorf Hotel, an opulent German Renaissance marvel designed by the eminent architect Henry Hardenberg. 4 years thereafter, itching with family rivalry, William's cousin John Jacob Astor IV would grace the adjacent plot with the towering Astoria Hotel, its particular design entrusted to the celebrated architects Schultze and Weaver. However, trouble was soon afoot in the family's game of hotelier thrones. In its inaugural year, William's Waldorf Hotel faced skepticism and was colloquially known as Bolt's Folly, attributed to the proprietor George Bolt, with critics condemning the luxurious hotel as a blight upon a respectable neighborhood. However, parrying the media's doubt, Bolt ingeniously planned a charity concert for St. Mary's Hospital for Children the day after the hotel's opening. With tickets priced at $5, $163 in today's currency, New York's elite filled the grand ballroom, dismissing earlier skepticism. Thus, by the end of its first year in 1893, the Waldorf had generated an incredible $4.5 million in revenue, an astonishing sum for the time that would equal over $100 million in 2023. Not long after, in 1897, John Jacob Astor IV inaugurated the Astoria Hotel adjacent to the Waldorf. Quickly seizing on an even larger opportunity, the cousins soon agreed to a truce, creating a unified entity known as the Waldorf Astoria. With 250 feet stretching from the sidewalk to its highest point, this combined colossus reigned as the world's largest hotel, having the buildings eventually being connected through a 300-foot marble corridor known as Peacock Alley. This Peacock Alley was soon seen as a grand promenade for the who's who of New York high society that connected the Waldorf and Astoria hotels, becoming an enduring symbol of the combined social and business establishments. Now, at a staggering expenditure of approximately $5 million, equivalent to $138 million today, the Waldorf Hotel graced Fifth Avenue and 33rd Street with its German Renaissance structure, consisting of an impressive 450 guest rooms, 15 opulent public rooms, and an additional 100 rooms designated for staff. Intricate architectural features such as loggias, balconies, and gables adorned the exterior. Inside, a breathtaking garden court featuring fountains and terracotta walls offered a sanctuary of splendor. Sienna marble, mosaic tile floors, and a coffered ceiling framed the entrance hall, immediately declaring the building's opulence to anyone crossing its threshold. Delving further into the Waldorf, you could see a marble entrance that leads to the Empire Room. This dazzling space, furnished with an alcove featuring elevators and a grand staircase, swiftly gained notoriety as one of New York City's premier dining establishments, rivaling even the likes of Delmonico's and Sherry's. You see, the room was an empire-style marvel, resplendent with mahogany pilasters, gilded accents, and lavish frescoes. Adjacent to this culinary delight was the Marie Antoinette parlor, an elegant reception room graced with 18th-century European antiques, including a cherished bust of Marie Antoinette. Bearing artistic excellence, the ceiling showcased frescoes by Will Hycock Lowe, with the Birth of Venus as the central piece. Further enhancing the hotel's splendor was the Gentleman's Café, a hunting-themed sanctuary adorned with robust black oak paneling and staghorn chandeliers. This was complemented by suites such as the Henry IV drawing room, furnished with rare French and Italian antiques, as well as a banquet hall seating 20 and a music room. And while the Waldorf was indeed a paragon of opulence, its sibling, the Astor Hotel, was no less grand. Opened in 1897 and situated at the intersection of Fifth Avenue and 34th Street, this 16-story marvel was also designed by Henry J. Hardenberg. Boasting 25 public rooms and 550 guest rooms, its dimensions were grandiose, extending 270 feet from its sub-basement to its roofline. Constructed of stone, marble, and brick, its architectural style was a harmonious blend of French Second Empire and Austrian Baroque influences. A double set of plate glass doors graced the entrance, alongside a U-shaped driveway for carriages and horses. As you would navigate the Astor, to the left of Peacock Alley, resided the Astor dining room. This expansive space showcased Italian Renaissance pilasters, Russian marble columns, and silk hangings in rose pompadour. Directly opposite lied the Garden Court of Palms, a triple-height dining venue adorned with a dome-like roof of amber glass. Here, the Italian architectural influences were elegantly portrayed through grey and terracotta hues, embellished with pavonazzo marble. The café, found on the 34th Street side, was a spacious room finished in English oak and accented with German Renaissance and Flemish decorations. Proceeding to the first floor, you'd find the Astor Gallery, a luxurious space graced with towering French windows and a color scheme of blue, grey, and gold. Nearby, the colonial room contrasted its red ambience with white woodwork, adding another layer of complexity to the design palette. On the second floor, a private suite of apartments in old English oak offered a range of amenities, including large drawing rooms and a butler's pantry. And above the third floor, the hotel transitioned to suites and bedrooms, each offering unique luxuries like individual baths and spacious trunk closets. However, the crown jewel in the Astor was undoubtedly the ballroom. Conceived in the Louis XIV style, this grandiose space could accommodate 700 guests for banquets and 1,200 for concerts. Adorned in shades of ivory, grey, and cream, it welcomed the most cherished voices of its day, with season tickets for musical performances costing up to $350, around 12 grand in today's dollars, underscoring the high value placed on cultural offerings held within these hallowed walls. Upon entering the zenith of the hotel, you'd find a paradisiacal roof garden encased in glass, adorned with rattan furnishings in shades of pale green and pink. A stroll along the 34th Street side revealed the grand promenade, Peacock Alley, a lofty terrace furnished with a bandstand, fountains, and trellises. Adjacent was the roof garden restaurant, possessing a high ceiling that stretches 24 feet above the floor. At the corners of this exalted realm were spiral stairways within towers, ascending to the copper roofs of pavilions that stand a staggering 250 feet above the ground level. Thus, from its subterranean machinery to its skyward gardens, from its shaky beginnings to its golden reputation, the Waldorf and Astor hotels embodied both engineering excellence and unparalleled luxury, forever imprinted in New York's architectural and cultural history. Now, from their earliest days, both the Astor and Waldorf hotels became synonymous with glittering social events, with philanthropic dinners and balls frequented by luminaries like Andrew Carnegie. The resplendence extended to hosting dignitaries like Viceroy Li Hongqiang of China, who in 1896 imported 100-year-old eggs and even his kitchen staff. Upon his departure, Li graced every female guest with a basket of roses and lavished generous tips on the hotel personnel. The Astor and Waldorf additionally pushed the envelope in hospitality, from Prince Henry of Prussia, who enjoyed a private door and elevator, to a staff forming an emergency bucket brigade for his royal bath, the level of service was unparalleled. Exclusivity extended to guest policies as well, allowing only registered individuals access to rooms, thereby upholding a superlative standard of etiquette. Membership clubs within the premises offered perks like preferential pricing and discounted spa treatments, attracting an even more elite clientele. The Waldorf Astoria Bar, established in 1893, was the sanctuary of the city's financial magnates and vivid personalities, from Diamond Jim Brady to Buffalo Bill Cody. Even the cocktail world owes its heritage to this establishment, credited with inventions like the Rob Roy and the Bobby Burns. But here's the paradox. The very grandeur that made these establishments landmarks of American luxury also sowed the seeds of their own downfall. As we sit here basking in the glory of the Astor and Waldorf Hotel's most radiant days, a looming shadow creeps closer, whispering a harrowing question that we can no longer ignore. What catastrophic chain of events could pull these icons down from their lofty heights? Sadly, the halcyon days of the original Astor and Waldorf hotels soon met an inexorable decline. Compelled by an interplay of economic downturns, ownership transitions, and societal evolution. Thus, as the years marched on, the Astor family's grip on the hotel industry loosened, signaling a change in leadership that would have profound implications. Initially, these grand hotels had captivated New York City, hosting society's elite and even contributing innovations to the world of cocktails and hospitality. They epitomized luxury, becoming glittering settings for illustrious balls, philanthropic dinners, and visits from foreign dignitaries. But as the 20th century unfolded, fresh competitors emerged. Luxurious new establishments like the St. Regis sprung up, endowed with modern amenities that lured away clientele. The Astor and Waldorf found themselves as relics in a city that had moved forward, the glamorous heart of New York City shifting northward beyond 34th Street. Then, the Great Depression struck in 1929, casting a dark shadow over these citadels of extravagance. Eroded by financial constraints, their luster dulled significantly, setting the stage for a diminishing role in a city always chasing the next big thing. Adding insult to injury, the costs of preserving their architectural grandeur began to spiral out of control. Ensuring their structural integrity while maintaining lavish interiors became an insurmountable challenge, pushing them further into decline. Furthermore, as New York City evolved, so did its land value. The very ground upon which these hotels stood became coveted real estate, more valuable than the aging structures themselves. This paved the way for the demolition of the original Waldorf Astoria in 1928, making room for none other than the Empire State Building. Yet, although the original Waldorf Astoria was razed to make room for the Empire State Building, the legend was far from over. In 1931, a new Waldorf Astoria was resurrected on Park Avenue, and the name once again captivated the imagination of the public. This new location recaptured much of the original grandeur and became an iconic symbol in its own right, playing host to presidents, celebrities, and dignitaries. While it wasn't completely shielded from the economic and societal forces that had impacted its predecessor, the Park Avenue Waldorf Astoria stood as an enduring beacon of luxury, proving that the allure of a name could transcend time and place. Yet, despite this resurgence, a definitive end was marked for the Astor family's hotel empire on May 3, 1929, when they sold their remaining interests to the developers of the Empire State Building. The original structures disappeared, their once mesmerizing elegance archived in the New York Public Library. But the Waldorf Astoria name lived on, solidifying its place as an irreplaceable jewel in the crown of New York City's rich history. And now we'd like to see you in the comments. Have you ever been to New York's modern Waldorf Astoria building or the Empire State Building itself? We love learning about your thoughts on these topics, and we can't wait to hear from you. Thank you again for your viewership with us, and cheers until next time.